standing firm against opposition. And in our lesson, when we get into our lesson, Acts, the seventh chapter, and hopefully we've read the entire seventh chapter of Acts, but in our lesson, we're going to be talking about Stephen. And in Stephen, everything in today's lesson refers back to the Old Testament, for the most part, with reference on our Savior to come, the Deliverer. And in talking about, even within the title, standing firm against opposition, and that's something that we've been talking about one way or the other, probably for the last 6-8 weeks here at New Hope, being in our actual Sunday school class or the message itself given by the pastors, and or even in our Bible study. And that's all it's really talking about, is making a firm commitment to stand firm. Either we believe or we don't believe. And then in believing, we have to become just like Stephen. You're going to have to stand in your commitment at level. It has to be. Even if it's unto death, are you willing to make that stand? And so when we get into Acts, the seventh chapter, and if you can kind of have your Bible out, because we may read a couple of the other verses within that seventh chapter of Acts. So pull your Bible out. We are going to go pretty much according to text, but we also want to talk about some of the other verses. And in this lesson, I kind of like the brief summary that it gave at the heading of each of our sections, which was broke down into to a total of 5 sections. And this one, the first one said, it's the story of faith. And it says, the high priest who presides over the council proceedings has invited Stephen to make his defense against the charge of blasphemy, which is in the first verse of the seventh chapter. And it says, addressing the council, Stephen begins to recount the story of Israel, their story, and his own. It is a long story, but one the patriarch Jews love to hear. And that's the same thing that happens to us. We love to hear the history. We just don't always want to be held bound to it. And it was no different for the Israelites. They want to talk about it, but again, when we stray away from the laws, those things that are supposedly right, then we want to justify why we're doing whatever we do. There was no difference. So the first verse says, then said the high priest, and these things are. Second verse, and I'm coming from the King James Version. It said, and he said, men, brethren, and fathers, hearken. The God of glory appears unto our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia before he dwelt in Charan. And so in saying that, he's setting the stage for the story that he's going to tell them, which is simply the history of Israel. And so they already know it, but it was a good history, and we all like hearing good things because that is who we are. That's the makeup of who we are. And so he said this history has started over 2,000 years ago, and it says the distant land of the Mesopotamia is actually today what's considered Iraq and eastern Syria. So it's that region of the world that we're talking about, setting the stage. And we all know about how Abram at that time was called out to leave to a distant land. And so it's that Ur was where Abraham lived before he dwelt in Charan. And it said his obedience to the call meant that henceforth all Israelite will look to him as their common ancestor, the father of their nation. And so we know that that is still true even to today. Abraham is considered that father. And three said, and said unto him, get thee out of thy country and from the kindred, and come unto the land which I show thee. And again, this is Stephen talking, and he's just retelling the story to the council so that he can let them know, because the charge is against Stephen, and Stephen wants them to know what's really going on here. And so if you went back and you did your study, we know that at that time it said Abraham was already 75 years of old age, and it said God had called him to just pull up his stakes, to just take his family and begin a new chapter. And again, this is Stephen retelling the story so that the council will become familiar with it. He had a point, but he had to get them there so that they could see it. Sometimes, you know, we become a little disconnected when things happen, and we get focused in on what our point is, but not necessarily what the point is. So he's putting them all into that same area so that they're all going to be thinking about the same thing at the same time, that commonality, what's common that we have. And so we have a question set. What do you think? What did you have to leave behind to follow Christ, which was the most difficult, and why? It said friendship, habits, attitude. What did you leave behind? I would like something from each of you all. Just tell me one of these categories, whether it was a friendship, a habit, or it was an attitude. Pastor Barnes? All of them? Your habits. Okay. Sister Barnett? And the reality of it is for all of us is that we do all have to leave all of those behind. And sometimes we, because we don't focus in on them, we don't realize the change. But when you think back, even when we first came to Christ, whenever that was, when you accept, but I know for all of us, as we've grown, even up to today, God is still pruning. And he's still cutting out some people, friendship, some habits, and some attitudes. And sometimes we don't even know sometimes that we have attitudes about something until it happened again. It ain't happened in 40 years. So you thought that was behind you, but something happened, and you get that same attitude all over again. So he continues to prune us. But and you know, that's something that we all have to think about on a personal level, at a daily basis, because it does sometimes become difficult. God wants to move you beyond something. We say here at New Hope, we quite often paraphrase Romans 8:28. We say sometimes when things start happening, you don't want to let it go, and we pull those things back. Well, that's the same thing that the Israelites were doing. They want to believe in this Savior and this Messiah, but again, though, we know that that's so distant in their future, because, and we have the same problem. Unless something comes the way that our perception, we don't think it's come. We don't think it has arrived yet. And so they had the same issues and the same problems we have. We don't want to let go those things that we think are important. And those things that have allowed us to have some substance, we want to keep it. I want to keep my popularity. I want to keep my position. I want to keep my status. And even though I want to be a child of God, I want them to recognize this about myself. So are you really, really, really willing to let things go? We have the same problem even today. 4 says, Abraham's response was, then came he out of the land of the Chaldeans and dwelt in Charan, and from thence, when his father was dead, he removed him into this land where he now dwell. So Stephen is telling him that this is what had to happen, that he was with his father, but when his father died, then God took him to a further distance. And so he's just recounting the history again. It's nothing new. They've heard it from the time they were born, little babies on up. So they've heard the history, and they've done, and they know it just like he does. And, you know, we like to hear things that sometimes that make us feel good. So we like to hear it, and we'll listen to it over and over again. And some it's because sometimes it has a good feeling about it. Heading Tuesday's story of betrayal. And it says Stephen uses these passages to add detail to his review of the of Israel's history. And reading that, I would
Can you read for me? It's not in our
printed text. Can you read verses
5-7?
So, you know, it's just so important that we understand that Stephen is
setting
so that they can understand.
Sometimes,
even in our history, we forget some things that are very important about us being where we are now.
Acts 7, verses 5-7.
Correct.
In the NIV interpretation of the Bible. He gave him no inheritance there, not even a foot of ground. But God promised him that he and his descendants after him would possess the land, even though at that time Abraham had no child. God spoke to him in this way: your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and they will be enslaved and mistreated 400 years. But I will punish the nation they serve as slaves, God said, and afterward they will come out of the country and worship me in this place.
Thank you. See, and again, that's the history. And they know about it. We know about it now. That was
the promise that God had given Abraham. And as he stepped forth, even though Abraham did have a child at that time,
and
he was 75, it was still the promise that God had given him when he stepped out.
And Abraham that responsibility of leaving and being obedient. He set the stage for all Israelites, all children of God, for the future generations. The Bible tells us
that's up to 1,000 generations.
So we're talking about 20, 30 years. God has a plan. And so here in verse 8 he's saying, and he gave him the covenant of circumcision. So Abraham begat Isaac and circumcised him the eighth day, and Isaac begot Jacob, and Jacob begot the 12 patriarchs. And so
if you're talking about that, you're talking about the circumcision,
and that was a act. That was an act that
a sign
for a seal.
That's what the circumcision
started out to be of God's promise that he had given Abraham. So
on the eighth day, the male children
was doing that covenant, it was saying that God's covenant, they were going to be obedient
to God himself. God was going to be their leader. Abraham was going to follow God in the things that he was going to say and do.
And they regarded God as being their Lord from the beginning. That's how God designed it. He set it up that way. Abraham was obedient, and he did just what he was supposed to do. And as it said in verse 8, it said Abraham did it for when he had Isaac. Isaac did it when he had Jacob. Jacob did it when he had all his 12 sons. And so those were the patriarchs, were the 12 sons of Jacob, and we know who those they were. And so in verse
9,
with envy, sold Joseph into Egypt. And now what Stephen is doing is he's just giving a brief recap of the history. And so we know what happened. We know that the older brothers, not Benjamin, were jealous. They were jealous of him, envious, because they felt that their dad, you know, Jacob loved him. But from their mother, he felt that talked about that before. And so they sold him. They were going to kill him,
but they sold him. So they sold. But again,
once we have learned the history,
we all know that that's part of God's plan.
And our vision, or when we have things, or our level of understanding sometimes is only about right now. God knows the future. And that's going back to that Romans 8:28. All things working for good for those who love God and are called according to his purpose. So things happen, and sometimes we get stuck on the things that happen, but it's God's plan. You got to understand that. We may not understand everything that happened. We certainly won't understand it now, but it's part of God's plan. So he has to do some things, and some things that happen, just like with Joseph, will shake us up. But he got to shake you up in order for you to move, because sometimes we get set in our ways and we won't move because we think we know what's going on. God said, your dependency is on me, not you and not nobody else. It's me. Look to me. And so, again, Stephen is just recapping this, and he said in verse 9b and 10, it said, but God was with him and delivered him out of all his affliction and gave him favor and wisdom in the sight of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and he made him governor over Egypt and all his house. And we know, again, we know the history. We know that even though they had sold him into slavery, and we know things that happened in Joseph's life when he was there in Egypt that set him up. As it said, in spite of the conspiracy against Joseph, God was with him. And the same thing happens to us. In spite of some things that happen in your life, God is with you.
You have to believe that.
The things begin to manifest in your life. You got to recognize that it's God. We say we're going to be led by the Holy Spirit. We pray that. Holy Spirit, lead God and comfort me. And then as soon as he do, you want to rebel and go the other way. But he's reminding them of Joseph, that patriarch, and what happened with him. So when they sent him to Egypt, it said, first, Joseph was favored in the eyes of Potiphar and made chief steward over all his house. And it said, then after Joseph was unjustly thrown into prison, because, you know, his wife wanted Joseph, and because Joseph rejected her, she went right. And so we know that. And so it said, God gave him favor and wisdom in the sight of Pharaoh. And so even as those things were happening, again, anybody else on the outside looking in is going to say, wow, poor Joseph. He was sold into slavery because of his jealous brothers, and now he's there, and the wife of his owner is attracted to him. And because he rejects her, now she has him falsely accused and thrown into prison. So what more can happen? But God is still using Joseph because it's still his plan. And so Stephen, again, is just trying to put them back in memory of what happened to Joseph and see and look to God and see how God is controlling that situation. So he said, Joseph was even put in charge of the palace, and all the Pharaoh's people had to answer to Joseph. Because, again, this is God's plan. And it said, the one rejected and scorned by his brothers was lifted up by Jesus, by God, to be a ruler. And this is symbolic of what happened to Jesus. It's the same thing. So God has a plan. And we always think that God is constantly changing because we change. But God is straightforward. And then once you learn the word, you begin to see it. And that's what where your obedience comes from. That's why God said you can't be double-minded. Can't be here today, there tomorrow, and just all over the place. Put your focus on him. It said this is the point that Stephen especially wants to impress upon the members of the council. They are part of that. They are part of the people. At one point in time, you were rejected because you're part of Joseph. It's talking about you too. You have to know your history. Question is, how has God delivered you from afflictions or other disasters? It said in matters of faith, in matters of others' envy, in matters of your own insecurity or immaturity, are there areas that God has delivered you from those afflictions? And has he done that? I know he has. I know he has for all of us. And we've talked about it many, many times before, whether it be in family, it be in friends, it be on the job, it just even be in your neighborhood or just places you are, even in the church. It happens everywhere. But our faith and our belief and our trust is in God. His ability to do, not ours. So section 3 says, story of deliverance. And that's going to be found in the 17th verse of the 7th chapter of Acts. It said, but when the time of the promise drew nigh, which God had sworn to Abraham, the people grew and multiplied in Egypt. So they're in Egypt, because we know that what happened is that the famine came on the land, which is in the other verses briefly. When famine came into the land, God had Joseph just where he wanted to be for his children. Not starve to death,
and that would be in the land
with milk and honey. There would be plenty, because God had shown Joseph how
to store food,
because he shown him that the famine was coming. So again, this is God's plan. He already knew. Joseph was found to be an obedient,
and because of his obedience, and Pharaoh recognized that Joseph was a special man, he allowed Joseph to be in charge,
and Joseph covered everybody by his faith. By his faith. So this famine that had come along, again, Stephen is just recapping. He said, they may have not realized at the time, but two specific predictions were being fulfilled. One is that the descendants of Abraham was multiplying, and it said, two, the 400-year sojourn in foreign land was just beginning. Egypt was the foreign land. They were just beginning to that 400-year reign that they were going to live in Egypt. And it said, Stephen was summarizing Exodus 1, verses 1 through Exodus 3 and 6. It said, in the changes, it said, circumstances changed for the worse for God's covenant people. It said, by the end of the 400-year period, the Israelites had been reduced in position that from that of a honored guest to slave. God raised up a deliverer, Moses. But in that, what happened is that as the old Pharaoh, and it's like anything, as people die, as our loved ones die, our elder generation die, then history sometimes die with them. So things that were, if it's not passed down, then they forget. And so
by now, there's a new Pharaoh that don't know nothing about Joseph, don't know nothing about the history.
And he look up, and what has happened now is it looked like the Israelites are outnumbering the Egyptians. And so we won't get into that for the sake of the story, but you know what began to happen, and that began to happen and foster another jealousy and another concern for the Egyptians. So what it says in verse 33, and it says, this is God's plan. Then said the Lord to him, put off thy shoes from thy feet, for the place where thou standest is holy ground. Prior to that, we know about the history of Moses and what Moses had done. He was, as a babe, he was put in the River Nile so that he could be raised as an Egyptian. Again, God's plan. So here Moses is at this point in time. Moses had already killed the Egyptian soldier, and then when he went the next day and to confront a situation between his Israelite brothers, they turned
him. Yeah.
And said, "Who you gonna kill me like you killed him? What you gonna do?"
And so
sometimes those things happen even with us. So Moses fled. And in fleeing, he went to Midian. But what happened is, again, this is God's plan. in that 33, when Moses got there, it said, then one day he saw a burning bush and a bush that flamed but was not consumed. It just continued to burn. It said when he went in to investigate, he heard the voice of the Lord, as Stephen quotes. And again, take your shoes off because you're standing on holy ground. It's referring to being in reverence of God, being in awe of God and his power. We've talked about it here at New Hope numerous of times. I remember years back once when Pastor Barnes had said something at a Bible study class about how we come in with any and every manner of conversation and we do all these things in God's house. And she was saying it to make us understand that we were not holding God in reverence in his house. And unfortunately, I don't feel that many of the members understood. They didn't understand. And I say that to say that if we understood, then when we come in the doors of the church, we will want to take our shoes off because we are standing on holy ground. So all manner of conversation, all manner of action stops at the door. This is a place of honor. It's the only place that's high and lifted up. We say that, but we got to get the right understanding in our spirit about what that means. And so Stephen is letting them know that God had here he has another one of his chosen children that he has set aside to become a leader. And we know all about the history of Moses, how Moses felt about it, and what God had to do. 34 says, I have seen the affliction of my people, which is in Egypt, and I have heard their groaning, and have come down to deliver them. And now come, I will send thee into Egypt. So God he's listening to them for 400 years as they would have been given out to slavery, captivity. And we know, according to God's plan, Moses was the chosen one that God desired to use to lead the people out of captivity. If you ask any, we don't know. We don't know God's plan in its entirety. So you don't know when God has set you aside to raise you up to do what? Specific thing. You don't know. So our job is just to be obedient. And unfortunately, sometimes we do the same thing that Moses did. It says, Stephen, he quotes Exodus 3, verses 7 and 8 and 10. It says, and it makes a statement that said, wow, Stephen really knows his scripture. And he did know. And it said, but Stephen is not demonstrating his mastery of the fact. Nobody's trying to brag about what they know. God is using Stephen to get their attention, drawing their attention back to what they've forgotten. They've forgotten who it is and who God is. God is in control of this. And it said, Stephen is rather, his point is rather sketching the pattern of rebellion among God's people in the defiance of divine saving action. And that's what happens even to us. We become out and out defiant. We rebel against God's changes or his desires in our life. As he's leading us, we still rebel against it because it's not, we can't see it. And if we can't see it, we don't believe it's real. But God said, my thoughts are not your thoughts. My thoughts are high above your. So when we get to thinking that we got all the plan, we know it all from A to Z, then you ought to know that you're thinking of yourself more highly than you ought to. Nobody has all the plans. The next paragraph said, but most significant of all, Stephen quotes the prophecy in Deuteronomy 18 and 15 that God would someday raise up a prophet like Moses himself, one that the people must hear. It said, this prophet, like Moses, has turned out to be Jesus. Again, that didn't happen for another 2,000 years. And it said the prophet like Moses has turned out to be Jesus, and the recent rejection of him by the members of the council is at the heart of Stephen's counter charge as we shall see. And so
Stephen is recounting
all of this so that he can point them now back to the prophet that was sent to the people. That's his whole purpose,
bringing them
from where he
started
to right now, so that they can look up and recognize and see Jesus.
And
unfortunately, that doesn't
always happen. 45 says, section
4, it says the story of victory. 45 said, which also our fathers that came after brought in with Jesus into the possession of the Gentiles, whom God drave out before the face of our fathers unto the days of David. So what Stephen, and in the verses that were not read, and we won't read them because of time constraints,
what has happened is,
again, God is just Stephen is continuing to use those
people that were Israelites that God had used to be leaders to bring the children out. So
and we know the history, we know the pattern. They follow God for a while, and then they
stray.
They follow God for a while, and then they
stray. They
follow God for a while, and then they stray. Same thing we do. We follow for a while, we're obedient, and then we stray. We follow, and then we're obedient. 9/11 put everybody back in church. Here it is a few years later, and we're just as far from the church as we ever been, especially for in our generation. You know, people don't see the need to come out. They don't even see the need to
Jesus.
Of a higher power.
You got to know who God is. God is
a higher power, but he is the power. And you've got to know that. It's not some insignificant higher power. He is the power. And you've got to give him reverence. He's owned that. And so it said that now we're talking about another prophet, and it
said, after 40 years of wilderness wandering, a generation was finally ready
to trust God and allow Joshua to lead them into the promised land. So we know that when it talks in terms of Jesus here in this reference, it's really talking about Joshua. And it said, but Joshua, the Old Testament, and that's talking about his name. When it says Jesus is talking about the Joshua of the Old Testament men. And we know that Joshua came, he was the chosen leader after David. No, after Moses, I'm sorry. He was the chosen leader after Moses. And so he was with Moses. And he was one of two of those that were over the age of 20 that made it into the promised land. Caleb was another. And so God is that the land was possessed at the time by the Gentiles, the people of Canaan, with whom God was so displeased. So God is aware of everything. Everything, everywhere. We're the ones who may not be aware, but again, God's plan in making and him being aware of everything has allowed things to happen that we may not even understand. But if we're obedient to the Holy Spirit, that's all you have to do. You have to have a relationship in order to be obedient. Otherwise, you follow whatever you want to. It said, God therefore drove them out, giving victory after victory to the armies of Israel. And we know that when God told Joshua to do this and do that, Joshua was obedient. He did exactly what God said. When God sends you on a mission or he tells you to do something, and he said, do it complete, you're not to worry about what the residuals are. If he tells you to do something,
the reason he tells you to do it
is because
he knows it has to be completed. Anything that's
a half effort is non-effective because it's going to cause problems later on. And so it said, by the days of David, some 400 years later, 400 years later than Joshua. And Moses, the leading the children out of Israel, and that was 40 years. So we're talking about 440 years later.
And it said,
the Israelites were well established in the promised land. That land, again, flowing with milk and honey. 46, who found favor before God and desired to find a tabernacle for the God of Jacob. And now we're talking about David. Now, David is the prophet that we're talking about. And we know that David wanted to build a permanent home for God, but David was forbidden to build a permanent home for God because of the blood that was on his hand and because of the wars and things that he fought. And so, again, we can't get caught up in our own individual feelings about things. And sometimes when God is sending you on a mission, you the individual, you may have some blood on your hands. But God does not, he doesn't stop using you. But it may be that for the next level of whatever he requires to be done, he may not be able to use you. But he does have another someone, a ram in the bushes, what we call it. God has another portion of his plan yet to be revealed. And so because of that, God is still faithful to the covenant that he made. But he said in 47, because of David and what had happened to David, but Solomon built him a house. So God designed, and his desire was that Solomon would build him a house. And we know that Solomon did do that. And if you go back and read 1 Kings in the 5th chapter, actually you can start at the 5th chapter, and I think you can read on up to the 8th chapter. It will tell you how he did it, what he did, and give you full details about it. But according to God's plan, David couldn't do it, King David, but his son could. And so we have to understand in our lesson, it said, we know, it says, since Peter stands accused of saying that Jesus would destroy the temple, it is appropriate to honor the place of the temple in Israel history. So he wanted them to understand, because this is what led to them, the Jews, wanting to kill and Jesus because of what they felt, that was him blaspheming about what God was in the temple of God, not understanding that Jesus was the temple, not understanding that. And so he wanted, in this place in our lesson, he said, it is appropriate to honor the place of the temple in Israel history. And so we got to understand the power of God and everything that we say and do. And it said, the false accusation against Stephen had also been lodged against Jesus himself. Blaspheme. Not believing. Because they're still set on things happening the way their perception or the way they perceive it, not understanding. God's in control. Not them. It doesn't have to go according to what you see. Just be obedient to the Holy Spirit. Even then, be obedient. And so our fifth and final heading is called, it said, the story of murder. And this is going to be found in verses 52 and 53. And it said, now Stephen is shifting into accusation mode. Now this is the point. He told them all about the history to bring them all to a level of understanding. Now Stephen is going in for the kill. He's getting ready to make his point about why he said what he said and bringing and recapping them about the history. And it said in 52, which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted? And the recapping of the history, which ones did not prosecute persecute. Which one did not persecute? Even the only one that they didn't persecute was Abraham, because he was the father. But which one of them that he told the story on did you not do? Which one? Joseph? David? Who? Moses? Joshua? Which one? And it said, they had slain them which showed before the coming of the just one, of whom you have been now the betrayers and the murderers. We know as well as which one. We talk about Isaiah, you talk about Jeremiah, you talk about Ezekiel, which one? And we know that all of them died at the hands of the Israelites, of the Jews. And so now he's talking about, let's tell the truth about what really happened. And so at this point, because God has called Stephen to take a stand, Stephen is standing firm, as it said, in opposition. So he's coming back with a sharp rebuke. He's coming back with sharp words. He put it to him. What's the truth about this situation, he said, and regarding the persecution of the prophets? What's the truth? And it said, and Jesus had spoken the same thing, and it said, read Matthew 23 and 31. Those prophets had predicted the coming of the Messiah, the just one, the righteous man who would do God's will. Then when he did come, the members of the council had him killed. That's Stephen telling them. He putting it right there in their face. When it happened, you remember, don't you? You remember. You killed him. And so, and it said in the next paragraph, just as Peter and other apostles had harshly accused the council, so also does Stephen. He stands firm and he speaks truth boldly. They are guilty of condemning an innocent man, God's son. And that's the same question that we have to ask now. Are we guilty of condemning Jesus? Are we guilty of not accepting Jesus as our Lord and Savior? Do we not believe that our Redeemer has come? Do we not have faith in what it is that God is leading and guiding us to do? And so, Stephen is, you know, the Bible says that there comes a time where you have to have a righteous indignation. So you stand up in spite of the odds that are against you. In spite of it, we say it all the time here at New Hope. You and God, I and God make the majority. If God is for you, he is more than the whole world against you. Either you believe that or you don't. And when you stand in opposition, you got to be prepared to physically lose your life. That it comes down to that. It may happen. And you won't have but a second to think about whether you're going to stand for God or you're going to go along with whatever the enemy has put to you. And unfortunately, many people bow down. We've never heard of where the man, young man went in and killed them all. I mean, we are living witness. Even when we talk about the late Dr. Martin Luther King, he took a stand. And he said, I may not get there with you, but you will get to the promised land. And I know for many of us that heard his speeches back then, we might have been thinking about the promised land being here on earth. But the promised land may not have been earthly. It might have been heavenly. We will get to the promised land. So there comes a time when you come up against some opposition and you got to take a stand. You may not physically die, but we talked about it earlier. It may be a separation of family. It may be a separation of friends. It may be cause you to leave your job or lose your job. It may cause you to walk away from your wealth. Are you willing to take that stand for God? Are you willing to do that? 53 says, who have received the law by disposition of angels and have not kept it? Who? The commentary says, the rulers are tragically guilty of everything Stephen said. They know the law of God, so they should know what is right and what is their duty. They should know. But see, one of the things that happened to many of us, and quite often, a lot of the time in our lives, is that self get in the way. And when self get in the way, the flesh want what it wants. It feels justified in vindicating whatever it is that it desires. And it will do everything it can to receive what it needs. And that's why the Bible tells us constantly that the flesh and the spirit will not dwell together. The flesh being carnal, it won't dwell together because the flesh will always want what it wants. And we can either feed the spirit or we can feed the flesh. And it said here, they know the law of God, so they should know what is right and what is their duty. The law has been entrusted to them since given by God through the angels. That's nothing new. There's nothing, and the Bible tells us that in Mark, I think the 13th chapter, says nothing new under the sun. We've been foretold all things. But those rulers have failed to keep the law, just as so many earlier generations had failed, the council members are more interested in maintaining their position by pleasing the Romans than they are in pleasing God. So now we got the Gentiles and we got the Jews. And so the Jews are more, they want to keep their standing with the Romans as opposed to doing what it is that God said. And God had sent a godly man, because Stephen was one of the original seven that had been selected, and he was devout. And if you go ahead and finish reading that chapter, and it talks about, we know that at the end of all this discord, that they still stoned Stephen because they couldn't handle the truth. They couldn't handle the truth. They didn't want to be told that. They didn't want to be told what was the truth. Our last question said,
what are some aspects of
keeping the law of Christ? And it said talking point concerning what we are to do and what we are not to do. And that's an issue that many of us wrestle with on a day-by-day basis. And I'm not saying for any of us that it's absolutely clear all the time. Because all of us can get halted between two opinions, but at some point we got to take a stand. That's what Stephen's whole thing was about. And he was willing to. And it said that when he died, he looked up to heaven. And he saw Jesus sitting on the right-hand side of God. Meaning that when Stephen died, he died remaining faithful to God. He died remaining faithful to Jesus. And when he looked up, Jesus had a place of honor for him because he was welcoming him home. That's what it means, standing in the face of opposition, standing for what's right, not being led or guided or misdirected by what someone else's feeling is about what it is that they want to justify. And most of the time, our justification is that we want what we want, when we want it, how we want it. Ending up and closing out, it says, those claiming the name of Christ have sometimes played in the hands of skeptics by hating enemies, real enemies, and imagined, instead of loving them as Jesus commanded. And that's what we got to do. You know, even Christians, instead of loving someone, the word said, pray for those who despitefully misuse you, and we do just the opposite. We want to throw darts and stab him and everything. But the Bible said do just the opposite. And that's when we realize that we're growing in Christ. And we realize that God's raising us up, because you can begin to do just that. It's not, whatever happened to any of us, it's not about us. We say that, but yet we keep getting hung up. Get rid of that. It's not about you. We ought to be saying, well, God, why not use me? I consider it an honor, God, for you to use me. Because believe it or not, God has equipped all of us to do the things that he's given us to do. We get to choose whether or not we want to be obedient. But he's already equipped you. You can do what God has given you, Pastor Martin. You don't need nobody behind you, because he's behind you. You don't need no concurrence with anybody, Sister Barnett. You don't need it. You don't need nobody, Sister Harrison, telling you whether you're welcome or not. God said it. And that's what we got to begin to do. So we got to stand. You got to be committed. It's got to be a firm stand. It says, Stephen boldly accused the members of the Sanhedrin complicity in religious murder. He confronted them about what they had done to Jesus. You did this. Don't put it on nobody else. Don't say you didn't know what happened. You did this. And it said, just as their ancestors had killed the prophets who spoke God's truth, the council members had killed Jesus, the Messiah whom God had sent. It said the Sanhedrin's proved Stephen's point by killing him as well. Isn't that something? And Stephen knew that, but he was willing. He was with all the prophets. Once they got an understanding who God was and or Jesus in the New Testament, they were willing to die. It may happen to us, you all. As old as we are, we say, oh, well, I'm going to live however many more years I'm going to live, and I'm going to die a peaceful death. Look at what's happening in the world. There's some chaotic things happening. And we're going to, some of us may be called out without any notice, and you're going to have to take a. And again, that stand may require you to physically lose your life. Here, but the Bible says, do not be afraid of the one who can take your life. Be afraid of the one who can take both your life and your spirit. And nobody can do that but God. Closing out with our prayer, it says, dear God, thank you for the inspiring the heroes of old to stand firm in the face of opposition. Forgive us when we have faltered, but strengthen us so that their victory story may be repeated in our own time. In the name of Jesus, amen. Our thought says, stand for God, and he will stand with you. Either you believe it or you don't. It's as simple as that, you all. Either you believe it or you don't. So, and if you didn't have a chance to read it or study it, that came from Acts 7 chapter. Read that chapter in its entirety, and you will get a good understanding of what Acts 7 was about. For future reading, if you can read 2 Chronicles 36 chapter and 16th verse,